This is the axial section where I see this axial section is taken here at the level of the cervix. So when you see the myometrium is much more hydrated than the inner part of the cervical stroma. So the tissue over here becomes much more compact. So the normal cervix appears very, very dark, almost black on the inner side, and it is a little lighter gray on the outer side. So a section over here in an oblique axial cut is going to give me a nice little oval cervix over here. The little gray here is the endocervical mucosa. We have a little endometrial fluid out there, and we have the parametrial fat around it. Anteriorly, I have the bladder. Posteriorly, I have the rectum. I have the pubic bones on the sides and the musculature. This is a caudal section of the cervix. So let's go from posterior to anterior. I have the bones seen here, and then this is the rectum, which is straightened up. The uterus has just started showing up with the endometrial distended fluid and the uterine body. This is a little darkish partial volume averaging of the cervical part and some part of the cervix seen here. As I continue, what I want you to see over here is a nice black little serpiginous line that is seen on one side. This is the uterine artery. As it goes and feeds here, we see the contralateral uterine artery. And these arteries and the feeding of the artery and their branching is best seen in the coronal section. Again, the uterine artery. So when we trace it in coronal sections, it is seen very well. This is just a little zoomed view where I can see the uterine artery over here coming right till here and then feeding the uterus. Now, when we talk of the parametrium, this is an axial section of another patient. What do I see here? Bladder, small bowel, cervix, parametrium, and the bowel rectum. So there is a very nice article by Valentina, which has described how do you define the anatomy of the parametrium on the MRI. So they say that you draw an imaginary line across the anterior lip of the cervix and the posterior lip of the cervix. Then you drop down oblique lines. The oblique line is going to cross across a level, an imaginary plane of the uterosacral ligament. Now, uterosacral ligament is not something which is just sitting there as a very taut structure. It needs to be dissected well during surgery, and it goes in like a heart shape configuration. So from the uterus, it turns, curves behind, and it goes to the sacrum, and it is blended with the adjacent structures. So that is an approximate contour of the plane of the uterosacral ligament. So we draw imaginary lines. So this is just a pictorial depiction. Now what we are left with, the part of the parametrium, which is seen lateral to the cervix over here, this is called the lateral parametrium. What is seen anteriorly is the anterior parametrium, and what is seen posteriorly is the posterior parametrium. Now, you would want to say that this should have been the anterior and this should have been the posterior parametrium, but during surgical dissection, this is not really an open space. The surgeon needs to really dissect and get into a space, and if there is no infiltration by tumor, there is nothing really seen at this level which we see on an MRI so well. So we have the anterior, lateral, and the posterior parametrium, and we have the anterior vesico-cervical septum and the rectocervical septum. So this is a surgical picture intraoperatively taken where we see the uterus nicely. The fallopian tubes are kinked. Poor thing, it looks so taut and pulled. And we have the ovaries here. Now, once the uterus is given a tug, what happens is we can delineate the ligaments well. So we have a round ligament going across anteriorly and posteriorly the infundibulopelvic ligament. And this forms a triangle, which is called as the adnexal triangle. When the surgeon dissects further, we have the iliac vessels. They bifurcate into the internal iliacs and the external iliacs. So this is across the lateral pelvic wall of the patient. This is the uterus which has been displaced to the contralateral side, and we are trying to see across the structures of the broad ligament area, and the ureter is very faintly seen traveling here. So once the abdomen, the pelvis is opened up, the ureter is reflected medially. The next is the paravesical and the pararectal space. So these are, again, these are potential spaces which are not exactly seen very well unless the surgeon dissects out. So what they do is all these spaces are filled with loose areolar tissue and nothing is seen when the patient is opened up, but there is blunt dissection that is done to identify the anatomy that we try to see on our image. So anteriorly, this is the uterus. We will have the bladder here. We will have the rectum here. So the space which is next to it is called the surgical paravesical space, and this is the surgical pararectal space, and we have our parametrial region over here. Again, just another one, the uterus over here is totally taken up anteriorly. It is pulled and it is taut, and posteriorly is will be the rectal area. So this is the potential rectovaginal space. And we have the laterally, we have the paravesical anteriorly, pararectal posteriorly, and our broad ligament area. Again, anteriorly, the surgeon has to really dissect and dissect to get the bladder seen in the front. Here, the uterus is pushed behind, and that is the cervix, which is seen through the soft tissue. And we that is, again, another potential space not seen unless the tumor infiltrates out there. Obturator fossa, we see the nodes so nicely, but when it comes to dissection, so we see the branching of the iliac vessels and then everything is retracted. The peritoneum, we are extra peritoneum, the peritoneum and all the structures are pushed medially, and laterally the surgeon has to dip down or rather dig down and feel and palpate for the nodes and get the nodes out. So wanting to say here that dissection across the planes is definitely tedious. The visibility surely is poor, and the palpable findings also, of course, I'm not talking of skills of a great surgeon, but meaning to say something which is so well seen on our imaging, we must not falter in trying to give what is our best description. A normal node, nodes are debatable across the body when it comes to imaging on MRI. Various literature have proposed various findings, and some of them have not. I generally look at nodes as babies of the tumor. So if I have to comment on a node, I unfortunately do not really look at the short axis dimension, which is the norm. I would rather look at the morphology of the node and the morphology of the tumor, no matter which part of the body I'm looking at. I may be wrong, but I feel that the morphology probably has the best say. And a lot of literature is based on older imaging when the imaging was not so great. So somewhere the short axis dimension criteria do not really add on much to your specificity. So I would always insist on taking up the morphological basis. I just want to show a little very nice little line over here. That's an enhancing node. So something which is so reactive also shows a nice enhancement. So enhancement doesn't help you. Neither does a maintained fatty hilum, as we've seen enough in breast cancer cases. Pathology should be the same everywhere. It is proven at one place and not at the other. So I would say best to stick to the morphology. Now, looking at the MRI protocol, what do we do? So yes, we know the patient is kept fasting for about a few hours. Antiperistaltic agents, yes, we can give. Only thing, when we are only wanting to focus on the cervix, if for any reason, we may do away without an agent, because you don't really have a lot of artifacts coming and blocking your cervix. But if anything a little above, it's always safer to give an antiperistaltic agent. Empty the bladder prior to scan. This is a must. It sounds like just one point, but it makes a huge difference to the patient who's sitting in that cold AC room. First of all, we make them wait after changing for almost like half an hour, 45 minutes, and then minimum is what I'm saying. Then they are taken inside, and again, that much time, and they are old, the bladder capacities are poor. So I would emphasize that, you know, maybe an hour or 2 hours before the scan, it's good to empty the bladder. Very simple point, but please don't forget. Because what happens is, if you want to give contrast to a cervical cancer patient, the best, what you really want to see in a post-contrast is the dynamic phase. I will come to that later. In the dynamic phase, if your patient is going to move or shiver because of that full bladder and that AC, it doesn't help you, it doesn't help the patient. Okay, so please remember this. Consent and coils is okay for vaginum jelly. So times are changing, but still, I think on a single day, if we have 4 to 5 cases of review for cervical cancer MRI coming up, it is very unfortunate that we are still seeing cases which do not have per vaginum jelly. And we don't know sometimes what is happening. What jelly does is it distends up or it opens up the vaginal cavity. So what is seen as shades of black is nicely separated by a big shade of white in the middle. And the whole anatomy is well deviated. I will show you later. But it's very simple. It's just a catheter which needs to be passed per vaginal opening. And about 10 cc is the approximate quantity. We introduce lignocaine, which is sterile. So lignocaine is introduced and we just tape it up. And it beautifully distends up the vaginal cavity and the fornices. If you don't give a vaginal jelly, your black and white and gray description is a distinction or discrimination is not very great, and your interpretation falls down considerably. So a very small step, I think all of us as a radiology community, if you're not practicing, must be done. The nurses should be trained for that. It's not a very difficult task. Sequences, we have all sequences there in place. But what I would want to harp is, again, when we get scans for review, we are still missing out on the small FOV sequences. Please do not miss out on the small field of view images. They add a world of difference to your diagnostics. And with the little images, you cannot really make out much. And if you cannot answer that little one thing which the surgeon wants, it's a wastage of 10 to 15,000 rupees that the patient has spent. And the clinician says, what was the use of doing an MRI and spending all that money? So let's not do that. Let's scan the patient well so that we have better answers to give to the clinician and their trust is enforced upon us. Okay. And we have some large FOV sequences, just like other areas of the abdominal, dynamic contrast image if you're giving contrast. Now, staging. So one of the best things that happened in 2018 and one of the bad things. So I think in 2018, India had the worst incidence of cervical cancer. The better thing that happened in terms of imaging was that 2018, we had the new FIGO classification. Now, until 2018, it was like a blind era, okay, where the FIGO says that you have to do an ultrasound. And a per-vaginal examination, ultrasound if available, and then do a staging laparoscopic staging for the patient. And that is going to determine your stage. Now, there have been so many cases where we see that per-vaginal examination is free. There is no parametal infiltration. Ultrasound is not going to pick up all the minute things. It is good for a gross estimation. So I don't think when we see so many scans, the older FIGO version was substantially fair enough to the patient? I don't think so. But FIGO 2018 has changed. It has accepted imaging on a much more wider platform. The new FIGO 2018 classification states that use an MRI or a CT scan or an ultrasound in that order with whatever is available for the patient. The reason why the old FIGO did not harp on imaging was because cervical cancer is more common in the poorer socioeconomic countries, and people don't have money to get treatment. Where will they go and travel miles and kilometers to get an MRI done? So saying get an MRI done for the cervix does not work in our country if the patient is sitting in a remote area. But now what the staging says is if your institute has an available imaging, please go ahead with a cross-sectional imaging where MRI in the earlier stages helps. And then, of course, later stage would be a CT scan and then depend accordingly. So we have separate notations of R and P, where R stands for radiology and P stands for pathology. So FIGO 2018, I would say, is very, very welcome. There are certain changes that have come in. Stage 1A, we don't need to bother. It is microscopic. 1B is 1, 2, and 3. Right? So stage 1, 2, and 3 is where the tumor is 5 millimeters or up to 2 centimeters. 2B is 2 to 4 centimeters. And 1B3 is more than or equal to 4 centimeters. Now, earlier, it was only less than 4, more than 4. Of course, beyond 5 mm. So why is this? Because what they realize is that across 4 centimeters, the prognostication varies substantially, which is why there was a need to kind of split these into two separate groups. So we have a less than 2, 2 to 4, and a more than 4 centimeters in a 1B category. This is an example of the sagittal image of a patient with stage 1B1 disease. The uterus, the myometrium, the inner myometrial area, and then we come down, which is, we know is a junctional zone. When we come down, this is the cervical lip. Posteriorly, this is the anterior cervical lip. We have a very intact endometrial mucosa, endocervical mucosa. This is an exophytic tumor, partially endophytic, partially exophytic. The tumor is grayer than the normal blacker cervical stroma. This is the beauty of the pervaginal jelly, is that is what I'm saying. Now imagine there is no jelly. The jelly has not gone over here. What do we see here? This is the posterior wall of the vagina, and this is the fornicial area. This is not opened up. Now you want me to tell you whether the vaginal wall is involved, the upper third, or not? If there was disease here, I would not have been able to see. So I am failing with one of the answers that the surgeon wants. All right. Luckily, anteriorly, it is beautifully opened up. This is the anterior fornix, the bladder anteriorly, and the anterior lip of the cervix. It is a small tumor, less than 2 centimeters. And I know this is a very early cervical stage. So she has excellent prognosis, and there were no nodes seen anywhere. This would be a 1B2 as per the older classification, or the newer. This is surely more than 2 centimeters, but yes, less than 4. It is totally endophytic. So yes, it was not 1B2 any longer. This is now coming as a 1B3. Okay. Now, another importance of us imaging over here, because if the surgeon is to palpate this lady, the fornice anteriorly is kind of effaced, but not by disease, it's more by the mass effect. And posteriorly also the fornice kind of seems to be clear. The surgeon would feel a mass in the cervical region. The biopsy would be positive, but nobody would have an idea of the extent of the tumor superiorly. So the endophytic extent of the tumor, or the craniocaudal length of the tumor, this is what can only be picked up on an MR or an ultrasound. Even a CT scan may fail to show this soft tissue discrimination. So this is where MRI has to be done if it is available to the patient. Another case of a 1B3, where there's a large polypoidal growth coming down here, again, bladder anteriorly, the spine posteriorly, rectum here, the uterus here, endometrial canal, some amount of hematometra over here. And this is like a fibroid-like thing coming down, and you wouldn't really be sure whether it is disease or whether it is a polyp. And this is, again, the beauty of the pervaginal jelly. We see it in the vaginal area. And see how nicely the jelly has traveled around it. And we can see it all around over here. So I am very sure that there is no vaginal wall involvement in this patient, and that is where it helps us. This is a hematometra seen in a higher section of the uterine cavity. Now stage 2 is when it is going beyond the uterus. We have a 2A and a 2B. Now 2A is when only the upper two-thirds of the vagina is involved, and this tumor could be either less than 4 or 4 or more, which is again a 1 or a 2. 2B is with limited parametrial invasion. Limited over here is in italics because this is my nomenclature. Basically, it is, if there is parametrial invasion, it is 2B. But the moment it goes into too much parametrial invasion, it goes into a higher stage. So I would rather call it a limited parametrial invasion. So what is... Okay, this is a case where we see the uterus in the little parasagittal section, but the cervical disease is very well seen here. Pubic symphysis, bladder, rectum posteriorly. Okay, so this is the vaginal jelly in the body. So somewhere is the cervix and somewhere is the disease. I cannot see it separately. I go into a mid-sagittal section, and I can very well see corneal images. Now for endometrial cancer, other, we have grafts, we have washings, washouts, but for cervical cancer, most often they are hypo-enhancing. But what I would say, over the large number of cases that we've seen, that it is a differential enhancement that we see. The best thing to depict it in early diseases, look at the myometrial enhancement and look at the cervical lesion enhancement. If it is different, then you are worried about a disease sitting out there. So we can really see it very nicely over here, sagittal section. section and this is the axial section. Again, there is no parametrial infiltration anywhere. It is a very nice disease which is only involving the upper third of vagina. So this is a 2A1. There were no nodes anywhere. Diffusion, this is nicely restricted and this is down. The other thing where diffusion helps is if I would have seen a little angulation or something over here. So when we are in doubt, it's good to look at the diffusion and the dynamic post contrast. So you don't know whether it is fat or what is it. So I think diffusion and its fat contrast is also very helpful in telling you or picking up for subtle parametrial infiltrations. This is just a fancy image for a little break. Okay, so coming to stage 2A2 disease. So now here, this is just that it is a much more larger tumor. It is involving the anterior vagina here, but the posterior or the lower one third of the vagina is not involved. This would be a 2A2 disease. This is a case where there is obvious parametrial infiltration. So this is how parametrial infiltration is seen. You see that little wavy line and there are these whiskers seen out there. They are seen on both sides, but much more on this side. And so this would be a stage 2B. Now, parametrium infiltration is, you know, so this is the most important role of an MRI if you look at. So to remember, I say to be or not to be, that's your diagnostic dilemma. So 2B is parametrial infiltration, all right? Coming to 3. Now 3 is where, again, the revised PIGO classification has changed. Earlier, we had a 3A and a 3B. Now 3A is once the disease goes far down and the lower one third of vagina is involved. 3B is a little more than your limited parametrium, where if you have hydroureter or hydronephrosis, or it is further going laterally to extend to the lateral pelvic wall, that is stage 3B. 3C1 and C2 is based on adenopathy. 1 is pelvic, which is loco-regional, and 3C2 is retroperitoneal. So retroperitoneal adenopathy does not come as metastatic as such. It definitely upstages, and it is important to comment on them separately. Another thing which the surgeons always want is, or even radiation oncologists, if you're writing retroperitoneal, just don't leave it at that. For them, a good landmark is to see whether is to compare at the level of the renal vessels. So you can say retroperitoneal adenopathy below the level of the renal hilar vessels or superior to it, because that changes the surgical incision, the surgical approach, as well as the boost for radiation. This is a 3A, where we have the uterus here, the endometrial fluid. The disease extends from the uterine corpus to the cervix and down into the anterior vagina, almost involving up to the lower third. And the posterior vagina is so very well delineated, it is not involved. The bladder is also totally free. This would be a 3A. Now, 3B. This is another debatable topic which we often discuss in our multidisciplinary meets as to what is the lateral extension and what defines your lateral extent of tumor. So when you look at the radiation oncologist, they would say that they look at the inner vessels, the inner wall of the external iliac vessels. So if the tumor is sitting very close to it or in about a millimeter close to this distance, they consider it as extension to the lateral pelvic wall, and that matters to them because that will decide how much radiation they want to give in a graded basis up to the lateral pelvic wall. We understand that it is the bones and the musculature covering the bones, which would be the lateral pelvic wall. The vessels are traversing through this. The problem of calculating distances is I personally also have seen the amount of fat. Now, if you look at this lady, she has a lot of anterior subcutaneous fat also in general. And there is a lot of fat over here. So if this lady was a very thin asthenic lady, the amount of intra-abdominal, intra-pelvic fat over here may have been lesser. In that case, this disease here in the cervical region with biparametrial infiltration, it is topping here. It would have gone much more over here. Okay. So this is when we see a very abrupt stoppage of the disease across the plane. This, I think, it is close to your lateral pelvic wall infiltration. The surgeons deny of an existence of a true anatomical or a true surgical plane which stops the disease like this, but we always see it on MRI, and I would say that this is extension almost up to the lateral pelvic wall is how I would report, though it seems to be very far away from the muscle or the vessels that we see. However, I see a little twig of soft tissue here that could be a vessel, that could be disease. So I would look at my dynamics and my diffusion. Nonetheless, this sign that we see of tumor extending right across and almost stopping across a line should be something which is a more advanced disease. So the same patient looking one section higher superiorly, what am I seeing over here on the left is a nice ureter, and there is another ureter over here on the contralateral side. So bilateral hydroureter more prominent on this side. And however, luckily, I wouldn't break my head too much in this patient because as I come higher, there is frank parametric infiltration going in almost abutting my vessel. So there is no doubt this is surely going and hitting the lateral pelvic wall. This is a sagittal reconstructed image where you very nicely see the delineation of the dilated ureter. And this is the parametrial disease, which is seen obstructing the ureter. And we have the bladder anteriorly, and perhaps there are some perivesical deposits also. A mid-sagittal section showing us the disease better. And this is a contralateral hydroureter stopped by this. So sometimes you need these SAG sections, you need to see, because the urologist would call sometimes and ask for, how much is the length of the ureter involved, and yeah, more questions like those. This is another patient where a CT scan was done. So now something like this, where the surgeon feels that there is disease, there is parametrial infiltration on clinical examination, and they're suspecting a higher end disease. And if the ultrasound has already shown hydronephrosis, we don't need to spend money on an MRI for this patient. It is redundant for this patient. Only indication left would be that the radiation oncologist wants to map the disease for RT planning. All right. However, these patients can also undergo a CT staging almost with near fair accuracy. So this is a cervical disease very nicely seen here. And there is bilateral hydronephrosis seen on the higher section. This is a patient where I had shown you the parametrial infiltration earlier, and I would say this is a 2B, but what I didn't show you earlier was this node sitting out here. Now, if I measure this node, it is not very different from my artery. This would be some 3mm or 4mm in my short axis dimension. So does it mean that I should call it as reactive? No, because this signal intensity of the node on T2 is going to be my tumoral signal intensity. Nodes are not like this. So I don't think we need to be checking more on the sizes. It's time we recognize how the node looks like. Okay. Coming to stage 4, 4A is a 4A and a 4B. 4A is bowel or bladder wall involvement without villous edema. We'll come to that. And 4B is extension beyond the true pelvis. So this is the case of, is it the bladder? No, the bladder is here. So this is a gross hematometra in the uterus of a patient with a large cervical disease, and that's the vagina, some little fluid or jelly out here. The bladder is collapsed anteriorly. So let us look at the plane. The plane, we would say the cervical tumor is abutting the posterior wall of the bladder, but the bladder has an abnormal signal intensity. Let us trace the bladder wall. It is dark, dark everywhere, but here it is thicker and it is more gray. But I still can see this little black serosal kind of a margin out here. And so is it a tumoral spread or is it not? So this is classically called as bullous edema. And this is because of the congestion or the engorgement in that area, and it is not because of disease infiltration. So this is something you should keep in mind. And what helps the best to diagnose this, I would say, is a small FOV T2, where we see the nice little black line demarcating the two, which you would only see in one or two sections and not all the sections. So we have to see each and every section very carefully. The second thing that helps is seeing the diffusion. The diffusion restriction in the tumor will be much more than this edematous change in the bladder, but sometimes it may be difficult to distinguish. And the third weapon in your hand is your dynamic post-contrast sequence, where your tumor and the bladder wall may enhance differentially at different points in time of your dynamic phase. This is a case of stage 4A, where we have the posterior vaginal wall. The anterior vaginal wall is just not seen. This is extending out into the perineal soft tissue, frank extension into the bladder, and this would be a 4A. This lady really unfortunately had no idea she was dealing with a CA cervix, and she presented only with backache. She was sent for an MRI, spine, and we see, so she went as a metastasis of unknown origin, primary, and yeah, lung mets and bone mets everywhere. And then there were these retroperitoneal lymph nodes, which were, you know, kind of seen well, and then lower down, of course, and she was picked up as a CA cervix case. Now, talking of adenopathy, as I have mentioned, you need to mention the sites, because even though the surgeon is going to go dissecting out all the areas, it does help them to know preemptively where and how much is the extent of disease. So the perivisceral nodes generally are around your area of concern. We have the internal iliac, external iliac nodes, and the common iliac nodes. Short axis dimension, we always mention, I harp more on the morphology. Nodal metastasis, they correlate well with the presence of perimeter invasion by the primary tumor. So if I am seeing a disease and if I'm wondering that is there perimeter infiltration, yes, no. But if I'm seeing one node, which is like really like a metastatic node, I don't think I would want to break my head much, because the prognosis of that patient and the treatment of that patient is pre-decided. Your little bit here and there or raising a concern or a question mark will not change the management. So when nodes are positive, and when you know they are positive, if they are accessible for a histopath confirmation beforehand, so then the patient directly goes for radiation. The patient need not unnecessarily go for a surgery. So even with no parametal invasion, but pathologically proven suspicious node makes the patient go for a radiation treatment rather than going for a surgery first. Sentinel node dissection is done for cervical patients also, and the commonest site is the external iliac, followed by obturator, and then followed by the parametrial site. So the implication is that at any stage which is lesser than 3B, you must look out for nodes, because this is going to upstage the disease. So a quick cheat can be to first look at your nodes, have a look at your cervix, look at your nodes, look at the entire field of view, what you have, and then start digressing one point after the other. So what are the FIGO recommendations? So as I said, now look at this patient, there is parametral infiltration high up in the disease. This patient may not have a pervaginal infiltration, which is like very, very obvious on clinical examination. Look at the bulk of the nodes and the hematometra. All this was picked up on the CT scan, but because the patient had not gone to a gynecologist first, the patient had gone to a physician and the patient was sent for a CT scan. So this same patient has this retroperitoneal adenopathy also. Now, if I was to do only an ultrasound with too much gaseous abdomen or something, sometimes nodes can be missed. Meaning to say, if you have the technology, you do not stop with an ultrasound. We need to have a complete staging done. This is an example of where, again, a clinician may not exactly find the extent of disease. Bladder anteriorly on the CT scan also, we can see that there is this cervical region over here, and there's a little strip of a tongue-like tissue which is going here. Now this, you can also tell me that yes, there is obvious parametrial infiltration going quite close, but not everywhere. It is just a very focal spread. This may be missed on a pervaginal examination, which is why a cross-sectional examination is important. And this kind of a spread is not going to cause hydronephrosis. So if only an ultrasound and a PV is done for this patient, it would be like a early stage one disease. Whereas this is almost going to be a stage, would somebody want to tell me? It is going right up to the lateral pelvic wall, even if it is just at one point, all right? So what is the impact of staging? The clinical staging definitely lacked and was found to be erroneous in a whole lot of patients in the earlier FIGO staging. Where do we score over? The endocervical tumor size, as I showed, the extent of parametrial infiltration, pelvic wall invasion, and presence of lymph nodes. The other role of RT planning is going to be like, this is the RT rod. Okay, these are the rods which are passed through the disease of the cervix, and then circumferentially we have radiation being given to the patient. This is the axial section. CT scan planning for looking at the placements of the rods. These are the brachytherapy rods. And this patient was a very, very nice, early disease. Look at the coronal section also, small disease, no nodes anywhere. Parametrium was not really involved. It is nicely confined. It's just a contoural change. small disease, but the lady was almost 85 years old. So because of her comorbidities, she went ahead not with her surgery, but with radiation with curative intent. And post RT, there was a very good response of the tumor seen here and complete fibrosis. And the patient has very good prognosis. This was a patient who came with recurrence of disease and of the vaginal wall. So the patient had hysterectomy after CS cervix, but the vagina is involved, bladder is involved, bowel is involved, with fistulous communication between the two, a very solid state for the patient. And post RT, there was a very nice response. This is intermittent phase, and this is final post RT phase where there's complete fibrosis and the patient is doing fantastically well. Look at the vault here and look at the vault here. So well, RT does treat the patients very well. This patient, which I showed, had a large volume residual disease in two. So I want to show you, look at the nodal size in the pelvis and nodal size in the abdomen. And post RT, the nodal size in the pelvis had nearly regressed and still residual disease in the RP area. So this, I think, does reflect the radiation dose given in the pelvis in the primary area and limitation because of the bowel toxicity. So there is a certain amount of radiation dose that can be given in the abdomen. So we can see a differential response. Spectroscopy of the patient, this is the choline peak, which is elevated nicely. And post-therapy, the choline peak is almost gone. So the spectroscopy also helps us to see in indeterminate cases. This is one patient where she had a lot of disease over here, and then she was given radiation, and the disease is seen over here also in the anterior wall. And post RT, there was this bright area seen. We have the bladder totally collapsed, the vaginal wall, rectum, some fluid, vaginal jelly here. We generally cannot get into too much of jelly in the post RT state because of fibrosis. We have a high signal intensity in the anterior vaginal wall, but in the post scan, post contrast scan, we see the nice mucosal kind of an enhancement with no enhancement in the center. So this is classical edema, which is seen in cases with post RT. You can use your diffusion also. We do need to mention the complications. So a delayed scan is a good idea to take in cases if you are doing a CT scan for a MRI, CT scan for a CA cervix post radiation. This is a yet delayed scan where we see the contrast, which is extending across with the fistulous communication and contrast into the vaginal lumen. This is another patient where she had post RT low backache, nothing really seen much. And then on the stir, we see that there are these high signal intensity changes, and the review was for whether it was a bone met or not. But we must mention the symmetry on both sides. Look at the symmetry, and let's go back to the T2. And the areas over here, we see a nice higher signal intensity. And what do we see here? So these are likely to be stress-induced fractures, which are because of post-radiation, because they all fall in the field of radiation, and they are within your quarter of radiation, and they're symmetric on both sides, okay? This is post-RT recurrence. She was incidentally picked up on CT, so even if a CT scan is done, I think we need to kind of have a little closer look. So what is the role of MR? Is to detect, to stage, decide the management, and assess response, and for planning. The role of CT is for higher and advanced disease and not for early disease. I would just brush through a few cases. I have 10 minutes, I see. So this lady, she again just came with presentation of back pain and radiating down to her right leg. And there is no rocket science in this. She underwent an extended staging examination, and there was lung mets here, and she had a cervical disease out there. Reason I'm showing is that she had undergone a PET CT actually, and the PET CT showed the uptake very well at all the metastatic sites and the tumoral site. So yes, it was a good investigation for her. This is another case where I would like to pay the emphasis on dynamic post-contrast imaging. Again, sagittal section over here. So bladder, uterus, this is a little bleb of a cervical cyst out there. And a beautiful exophytic cervical mass, I would say. Its beauty lies just because it is not really infiltrating the areas around. So it's bad to have the disease, but it's good to have an earlier stage disease. But we need to see more. So the fornix is nicely delineated by the vaginal fluid, both anteriorly as well as posteriorly. And we would look at all the sections. The anterior lip is also free. So the disease is only arising from the posterior cervical lip. So what we see in the axial section, so when we are finishing our round check, so this is all nice, but the problem is the soft tissue that we are seeing over here. So is there mild or minimal focal parametal infiltration from 12 to 2 o'clock? Yes or no is what we need to see. So we look at the diffusion, but such a small marginal change will not be, the resolution will not be picked up by diffusion. So let us look at the MR. So let's look over here. If you did only a routine post-venous phase, we have the cervical disease here. And then so there is something enhancing here and there is no distinction. We are still not sure whether it is parametral infiltration or not. Let's go back from our first phase, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth phases. And what we see in our area of concern is that whatever was enhancing over here is all arterial enhancement. The disease has not yet shown us any enhancement. This is a poorly enhancing tumor. And the fact that your arteries have been enhancing, and this is the plexus where we see arteries and veins intermingling. Now, when I look at this, I know all that I was seeing was just the vascular plexus, and there is no parametral infiltration in this patient. So this is how we need to go step by step. This is just a routine patient post-hysterectomy. Wanted to show you how it looks on the axial section, and in the diffusion, there is intense restricted diffusion, bright here and dark on the ADC map. This patient, somebody had a differential of a psoas abscess because there are these conglomerated non-enhancing structures tracking along the psoas. This is just a reformatted CT view. But we come down tracking, and this is what we see here, and the disease is very well seen tracking along the psoas over up here, and the cervical region shows the disease very well, and there is a suspicious node out here. So the point is that when we are looking at some finding with a certain tuberculosis or some differential in mind, we must look at the entire scan holistically. This patient, she has a bulky cervical disease out here. She was shown in the MDT, and yes, so definitely an abnormal cervix, but the problem was seeing this. The MR of the rectum, this is a CT scan, but this somehow did not look good. But my logic said there is so much bulkier disease in the cervix. So this must be a cervix, and somehow it is weirdly going to the rectal area and infiltrating locally and a 4B. But I was wrong. And this was an MRI of the CA of the rectum, which is going ahead and infiltrating the cervix. So yes, unusual things do happen, and logic does not always work. All right. So the checklist for our imaging would be the site of disease, the size of lesion, and the uterus, morphology of it, approximate percentage of stromal involvement is the anteroposterior or the width dimension of the cervical lip involvement. If it is more than 50%, if you can see that in an earlier disease, the patient will need radiation. Okay, so that is the implication that it has on management. Vaginal involvement, parameter involvement and the extent, whether it is going to the lateral pelvic wall, bladder, rectosigmoid colon, lymph nodes, and mention your level of suspicion and any incidentally picked up.